It's now an honor for me and a real pleasure to welcome the renowned Peter Schwartz to the virtual stage. Of course, for the people of seasoned foresight practitioners, Peter is not a stranger at all. Peter is an internationally renowned futurist and business strategist, specializing in scenario planning and work. He has worked with governments, corporations, and institutions to create some of those alternative perspectives on the future and develop strategies for the changing and uncertain world. Peter is now the Senior Vice President of Strategic Planning for Salesforce, where he's managing the organization's ongoing strategic conversation. Peter was also the co-founder and chairman of the Global Business Network, but is also the author of several works. His first book, The Art of the Long View, which you might have read, is considered one of the seminal publications on scenario planning. He's also been a consultant, a script consultant on some of movies, like the ones of Minority Report, Deep Impact, Sneakers, and War Games. So he has a bachelor in science in aeronautical engineering, that's a whole mouthful, and astronautics. But on a more personal level, I've had the honor of Peter sharing some of his time and advice with me when I was starting my career in foresight, trying to understand how I could bring value to these worlds. So I have the greatest respect for Peter. I learned so much from him, and I'm super thrilled to have him here with us today. So thank you very much, Peter. I'm really looking forward to your insights here as a preeminent futurist of our times.
Thank you.
Welcome, Peter.
Very kind.
So let's get immediately dive into the conversation. What we want to really hear from you is what your insights are about some of the pivotal uncertainties in the next decade. What should we be preparing for?
Thanks, Crystal. And let me say it's a pleasure to be with all of you this morning, and especially with Christelle. She is a dear old friend, colleague, collaborator. I won't say for how long, it would be embarrassing, but quite a long time, going back to the World Economic Forum, where we first started working together quite a long time ago. And so it is a pleasure for me to be here with her and with all of you. And I must say, just one thing before I get into it, I heard the end of the comment from Jesse Wendt about arts and the future, and I totally believe it. I consider myself a storyteller, and that's how you kind of see the future, is in these kinds of stories. Like, you know, my book has sold probably 1 million copies, but 2 billion people saw Minority Report, right? So, you know, the impact is really quite profound of stories like that. Okay, what I'm going to do is share my screen. I have a few thoughts that I want to share with you. So let me do that at the moment. I'm going to share my screen here. So I've been thinking about this question of discontinuities quite seriously, because I do think we're in a moment of really fundamental and discontinuous change. We're in a time where we're going to see lots of surprises, and we're in the whitewater. We're in what I call the rapids. And the rapids are an environment where there's an enormous amount of turbulence, a lot of confusion. You're pushed around by the water, and it's very hard to steer. But one of the most important things we know about steering in white water, if any of you have ever been white water rafting, is you have to go faster than you, and you don't know where you're going to end up. And so this requires a very different kind of foresight and a different set of perceptions in this kind of environment that we're in today. But this is not the perpetual environment, probably. So it is, first of all, learning how to navigate this white water that we're in right now with very confusing signals, very chaotic environment, and then how do we go on from there to see the longer term phenomena. And where we are now is precisely in that environment where we're seeing a number of simultaneous discontinuities. A number of years ago, I wrote an essay called Cascading Crises, where we're going to see a set of crises interacting together and creating a profoundly disruptive environment. That is precisely where we are. We're in this world of cascading crises. And I'm going to elaborate on each of these, but I think none of them are surprising to you. It's just that they're all happening at the same time. We are seeing this dramatic evolution of artificial intelligence that's really quite profound. And I'm going to come back to that in a few minutes. But what we're now seeing is that the completion of the system of the internet, the smartphone, and now artificial intelligence, that creates a wholly new technological environment. It creates the universal executive assistant for everybody. It's going to take the friction out of everything. So that's one disruption. The second discontinuity, obviously, is climate change. And I think this is not a future phenomenon. We're there already. We're in that world, and I'll talk more about that. And obviously, we're in a new geopolitical environment, right? China's playing a new role in the world. India's a new role in the world. Russia is the mafia state that is playing a really nasty role in the world. And all of these are putting pressure on the global institutions that have dominated the world for the last 75 years. And then finally, a new economic dynamic. We're moving from this world of relatively low inflation and modest growth into a much more volatile economic environment that we're already beginning to experience. So these are the kind of major discontinuities that are shaping the world right in front of us. And so here's some data that supports that. On the economic side, I found this really quite striking. The upper red line here is the inflation rate in the U.S. from roughly the mid-1960s to the mid-1980s. And what you see in the first bump there is the effect of the Great Society and the Vietnam War financing both of those. They managed to get those under control by the early 1970s, but then we had the first oil shock after the Yom Kippur War, and we see the big spike in inflation back up to about 12%, somewhere around 1974-5. Got it back under control. And then we had the second oil shock after the Iranian Revolution. And now we saw things really shoot up to around 14%. Then we hit an environment of 14% inflation, 20% interest rates, and 10% unemployment. It was a major economic catastrophe. Paul Volcker, the head of the Fed, really squeezed, and we ended up with a deep recession in the early 1980s. But only a few years later, it was morning in America in Ronald Reagan's world. So we've seen this swing up and down. And I find quite remarkable, if we look across the bottom, the blue line is the current inflation rate over the last few years. And oddly enough, it seems to be tracking almost identically with the previous wave of inflation. Now, you know, history is no perfect guide, but something's going on here in terms of the cycles of how we deal with inflation, the lags in the system, how interventions produce change, and so on. So there's a pretty good chance that we're seeing something similar here. We're now squeezing inflation. It's beginning to come down, but it's likely to stay, if anything like this, at a higher rate and greater volatility, the second and third order effects of what we've already done. So we're likely to see some volatility in the inflation rate, and that in turn leads to further impacts in politics, economics, et cetera. So that's the first of these new environments that we're moving into. The second is climate change. And climate change has been often characterized as global warming, and that's the wrong way to think about it. The right way to think about it is increasingly variable and extreme weather. More extreme storms, more extreme floods, more extreme droughts, all of that, more tornadoes. And so we're moving from that nice even distribution of weather between cold and hot and volatility. And what we're now seeing is more extremes. We're going to spend more time in the hot, more time in the cold. And that's how the climate changes. It becomes extremely variable and moving much more into extremes. The consequence, of course, is greater disruption, things like massive floods. I don't know if you all saw the pictures of the consequences in Germany last year of an unbelievably torrential rain that literally tore the heart of it out of a city and created a chasm where there hadn't been before. So torrential was the rains. Here in California, where I live at least part of the time, we've had the most massive snowfalls in decades. We're about to have, you can see it coming, a wave of floods as the summer melt happens. So that's the kind of environment we're in now, continual disruptions from extreme weather. And then, of course, now we're in this world of AI, right? And this is so striking. If you look at this chart on the left, it took us 16 years after mobile phones to get to 100 million users. Internet, 7 years. Facebook, 4.5 years. And so on down, ChatGPT, 2 months to 100 million people. AI literally took over the planet in weeks of it. I don't know if any of you have not tried the various things. You need to try it. And on the right, what you see is from our venture group at Salesforce, our view of the startups in generative AI, literally hundreds. We are invested in 32 ourselves. There's an explosive wave of innovation that has barely even begun to hit, and we've already seen this dramatic transformation. And what we're going to see is literally AI everywhere. We'll see it embedded in business processes. We'll see it embedded in governance. We'll see it embedded in our daily lives. Everyone will have what amounts to a highly effective executive assistant. You know, I sit near the top of a giant company. I have people to support me, but none of those guys do. Now they will. They will all have a very powerful assistance to carry out many things in the background where they won't have to think about it. And that's the key phrase. They won't have to think about it. Freeing up the cycles for doing other things, being more productive, more capable, doing things that uniquely human beings can do, being much more creative and so on. So interesting enough that Microsoft has just published a paper that maybe we're getting close to general intelligence, artificial general intelligence. A lot of skepticism, and I must say I'm doubtful, but the pace of innovation is profound. And then, of course, therefore, there are the concerns about it, privacy, jobs, all of those things. Now, our view is that initially, it will be job enhancing, make people much more capable. But the extreme case is service agents, call centers, right? Call centers are mostly going to be history because essentially we can do a much better job. We can get rid of roughly 80% of call agents, and 20% will still be needed for the more challenging ones, but 80% of the inquiries can be handled by an AI. Is this a terrible thing? Well, I don't think so. It's not a great job. And, you know, some of you are even as old as I am, can remember in the 1950s and 60s, there were typing pools. There were these giant rooms filled with women, all at typewriters, typing things like bank statements and the like. Those are all gone. Nobody misses those, to be honest. And nobody's going to miss big call centers where people are having a pretty tough job all day long handling stupid inquiries. So the stupid inquiries will be handled by the robots. So we're going to see a lot of change coming from this. It's highly discontinuous. And there's some early signals of other discontinuities that we need to take into account. I heard reference to what I think is one of those already in the previous talk, and that's mental health of the young people. In the U.S., what we're seeing is 22% of high school girls considered suicide in last year. This is remarkable. And what we're seeing in terms of treatment for mental health, for a variety of issues, the use of drugs for mental health is nearly a crisis. I'm astonished by it. And there are many theories of it, whether it's social media or other factors, unclear, but it is becoming a crisis. There's a major shift in government philosophy in the U.S. That is, government was the problem under Ronald Reagan and was until now. Now government is the answer, not the problem. And we see it in two big moves, the Inflation Reduction Act, which has nothing to do with inflation and everything to do with climate change. It's a massive wave of investment in renewables, clean energy of all sorts, and a variety of other things of that nature. And the CHIPS Act to stimulate the chip industry in the U.S. in competition with China. So this is the kind of the largest interventions we've seen in a while. And then finally, the banking crisis that we're seeing beginning to emerge. How bad it will be, we don't really know, but we've seen a dramatic increase in the number of banks that are in trouble over the last year. So these are some early signals of possible disruptions. So what are the scenarios? And I've given thought to three possible scenarios, but this is a group focused on foresight. So I wanted to show you something here as I lay out my scenarios. On the left, is the original diagram from the Shell scenarios in 1973 that Pierre Vach put together for his first scenarios for Shell. And it had looked at a traditional environment that was no longer possible and that we were in a new world. And we were in, is his view, the rapids at that moment. This was 1973, disruption from the first oil shock and a variety of factors creating the rapids. And then a new habitat of new scenarios coming out of that, which he then went on to describe in some detail. Well, I think we're in a similar world. That old world is gone now. The discontinuities have changed it. We're in the rapids that I've talked about already, and there are three scenarios at least coming out. I think new prosperity, over the falls, and the long rapids. And I'll talk about each of those very briefly. So we're in the rapids right now. We don't know how long it's going to last. It's very uncertain. We don't know how to get there. And critically, many of the controls that we've had in the past are highly uncertain. We don't know how well they're connected. So we don't really, it's hard to predict what the outcome of policy is. And I think it's a big challenge for policymakers. There's a lot of discontinuity in policymaking. But well, there are three scenarios that I think are plausible coming out of this. First, the rapids might last a long time. We may not get any clear picture. Could be another 5-10 years, major disruptions, a kind of social attitude shifts, lots of uncertainty, feels like we're always on the edge. In many ways, it's like the 1960s. There's a lot of innovation, a lot of upside, a lot of young people, a lot of change. You know, now it's all about gender. Then it was about race and women. So a lot of disruptions. This is a world that in many ways resembles the 1960s. So that's the first scenario. The second scenario is what I call over the falls. And by that, I mean, this is the real world of cascading crisis. This is the world where we might actually see for the first time in 75 years, superpower war. And we are now at risk for the war with China. Could happen deliberately, could happen accidentally. What we could see is massive climate disruptions. We could really see an economic collapse coming from that. Now, I'm not a believer in the AI apocalypse scenario, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe this AI leads to really bad things. All of these tend to overwhelm policy. And this is a world really out of control. And it is the darkest scenario I have ever presented. Because in my lifetime, I've never thought seriously about major war, including nuclear war. Now it is plausible. So this is a world that resembles more the 30s and 40s, 1932 to 45. Are we in 1939? Is the Russian invasion of the Ukraine the equivalent of the German invasion of Poland? It was still almost another year before the war started in the UK, before the Germans attacked the Brits and so on. So it is this the first battle of the next world war? Don't know yet. Big uncertainty. And then finally, the upside scenario. That is, maybe all this AI is a big new wave of productivity, new growth. A number of years ago, I wrote an article called The Long Boom in Wired magazine. Well, it actually played out, even though now we're seeing a similar level of technological change that could, in fact, transform the economy. And we see rapid change, as I talked about, across many facets of life. And so in many ways, this is a world, say, mid-90s to the mid-2000s, right? A world we've experienced of relatively robust growth, low unemployment, relatively stable, even if higher inflation, which we had then as well. So what we could see is a new wave of prosperity built around this new wave of technology. So those are the three scenarios: long-lasting rapids, over the falls, and the new growth era. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Peter. I think we chose the theme of our conference rightfully in navigating the storm with your scenarios. So of course, as a public sector entity as we are, it's really important to prepare for some of those futures, even if they're scary. Some of them are more desirable than others, but policy tends to take longer than some of those changes that might abruptly put us in a different future, as you mentioned. So thank you very much for this. So Peter, you've been doing, as we said, like a foresight for a long time and with many organizations and through different countries, different people. What has foresight taught you, and what would you give as advice or recommendations to decision makers, especially in the public sector, about the practice of foresight?
All right. So I'm going to share my screen again. I have one slide.
Here. Just do it.
Share here. And I'll bring it up. And here we go. Are you seeing the future of foresight?
Exactly.
Okay. So you're right. I've been doing this for 50 years. So I'm probably the oldest practitioner left alive. I've been on the internet and the ARPANET since 1972. So I've been online. So what do we need to do? First of all, in this kind of environment of the rapids, what we need are two things. Short-term scenarios, the ability to look at the uncertainties, not over 5 years, 10 years, but 6 months, a year, 18 months, because we have to navigate. And we have to find what are the early indicators of movement in that environment. So it requires a more fine-grained analysis of the indicators and really a focus on short-term scenarios. On the other hand, you want to have some influence on where you come out of the rapids, right? So you need to start thinking about the kind of outcome scenarios, as I did here, and then what are the points of leverage? What how do we maneuver our ship, as it were, in the to come out where we'd prefer? What are the scenarios? How do we prevent a war, even as we're dealing with turbulence in the current environment, right? We see the kind of stress between the U.S. and China. How do we navigate that, even as we influence the outcome? Next thing is AI. AI is a new tool. We have an enormous amount of uncertainty created by the AI, but the AI is an enormously effective tool. Everybody now has a very useful intern, research assistant to help do that, to help support it. I was writing an article the other day on the future of electric vehicles. So I said, give to my ChatGPT, give me three scenarios on the future of electric vehicles. And it actually did quite well, explained its logic, its uncertainties, and it actually, using my methodology, it created scenarios. Were they perfect? No. But as a starting point, they were actually pretty good. And so it probably saved me a half an hour getting started, right? And that's going to keep happening. On the other hand, we need to use it to understand the future of AI. I also asked it to do that, came up with five scenarios for AI. So it is a good thought partner in that respect. And then finally, we're in this world where the scale of discontinuity is really profound, and the forces that are shaping it are equally profound. What this requires is great leaps of imagination. It requires enormous imagination to see the other side, and really a deep dive into those economic, social, political forces, because these are profound forces. They're not just skimming along the surface. They're reinventing the world right now. So this requires both deep, rigorous thought and great imagination to see the future. And so those are some of my observations on the future of foresight and what we've been learning, particularly in this kind of environment.
Thank you so much, Peter. Yeah, policymaking is, after all, the art, I would say, of going from a non-preferred future into taking actions to get to a more preferred future, which is everything you're pointing out right there. So thank you very much for that. Peter, for sharing your views both on what is at risk and how we might deal with this in the future. Thank you so much, Peter. I'm very grateful you were with us here today.
Thank you all. It was really a pleasure to be with you. Thanks for having me.